Harper One and Harper Audio present The Art and Science of Connection. Why social health is the missing key to living longer, healthier, and happier. By Kasley Killam, MPH. Read by Cindy Kay. A note before we begin. For tables referenced in the book, notes on the text, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. For Marcus, Mum, Kara, and Zach, my unwavering sources of social health. Author's note. The stories in this book are all true, as told to me or experienced by me. In several cases, I changed names and certain details to protect people's privacy, or merged stories to further anonymize, and some quotes have been edited for clarity. I'm grateful to everyone who trusted me with their perspectives. My favorite part of writing this book was connecting with you. Communicating scientific findings in ways that are accurate, interesting, and useful is an art. The information in this book has been carefully researched, and all efforts have been made to ensure accuracy. The book picks up where the data leaves off, with insights from experts and everyday people. I hope this makes for an enjoyable read that is both rooted in evidence and blossoming through lived experiences. Introduction. The future of health is social. What do you do to be healthy? Let's say you follow the advice of doctors, health blogs, and wellness influencers perfectly. You walk 10,000 steps per day. You get 8 hours of quality sleep at night. You eat plenty of fresh vegetables and avoid processed foods. You work through challenges with a therapist. You meditate and take hot baths for self-care. Your physical and mental health improve as a result, but only up to a point. The problem with traditional health advice is that it overlooks one of the most important ingredients, human connection. You can't be fully healthy if you don't have a name to write down as your emergency contact, if you don't see family except for a few hours over the holidays, if you lack close friends to share experiences with, or if you don't have enough alone time to reconnect with yourself. You value your romantic and platonic relationships. But do you know they determine how long you live? When you spend time with family or friends, invite a coworker to lunch, or strike up a conversation with a neighbor, do you realize the interaction influences whether or not you and they will develop heart disease, diabetes, depression, or dementia? Health is not only physical or mental, health is also social. Social health is the aspect of overall health and well-being that comes from connection, and it is vastly underappreciated. Whereas physical health is about your body, and mental health is about your mind, social health is about your relationships. As we will explore in part one, being socially healthy requires cultivating bonds with family, friends, and the people around you, belonging to communities, and feeling supported, valued, and loved in the amounts and ways that feel nourishing to you. Decades of research have proven that connection is as essential as food and water, but this knowledge hasn't yet made its way into the mainstream understanding of health. And without it, we're suffering. Today, many people show signs of social health in decline. Over the past 30 years, the percentage of Americans with 10 or more close friends dropped by 20%. Over the past 20 years, the amount of time people spent alone increased by an average of 24 hours per month. Over the past 10 years, participation in communities, such as book clubs, sports leagues, and neighborhood associations, fell by nearly 20%. And according to a national survey in 2019, around half of adults in the U.S. felt as if no one knew them well. Researchers have documented similar trends in other countries. According to Gallup, 330 million adults around the globe endure weeks at a time without speaking to a single family member or friend. And 20% of all adults worldwide don't have anyone they can reach out to for help. These statistics stun even me, who read statistics like these for a living. This lack of connection is dangerous, increasing people's risk of stroke by 32%, their risk of dementia by 50%, and their risk of early death by 29%. But it's not just disconnection that takes a toll. An overwhelming amount of connection or unfulfilling connection does too. Whether introverts drained by too many social obligations, extroverts spread too thin, teenagers overwhelmed by social media, or communities enmeshed in conflict, many people's social scales are off balance. Meanwhile, hate crimes have surged, polarization has escalated, and people's sense of trust in one another is strained at best. This amounts to nothing short of a public health emergency. As we will explore in Chapter 10, leaders around the world are beginning to mount a response. From governments in the UK and Japan appointing ministers for loneliness, to the World Health Organization establishing a global commission on social connection. But what does this mean for you? What can you do in your everyday life to connect meaningfully with the people around you and live a longer, healthier, and happier life as a result? I've spent over a decade answering that question. This book reveals exactly what I've learned, presenting new vocabulary for how to think and talk about the importance of connection with family, friends, spouses, coworkers, neighbors, and other social ties, as well as specific strategies to be more socially healthy. Discovering the missing key. When I was growing up, the social world around me was complicated. At home, I felt loved and supported by my parents and siblings, but there were feuds, divorces, and estrangements that fractured both my nuclear and extended families irreparably. At school, I was confident in myself and had plenty of friends, yet I never felt that I fully fit in, and I was dismayed by the meanness I observed between cliques. Later, as an adult at work, I navigated being an introvert in a professional culture that rewards extroversion. Over the years, I moved multiple times to different cities, each time needing to figure out how to build a community from scratch while staying in touch with loved ones far away. By the time I was in my early 20s, I was convinced that all these pieces fit together somehow. But how? I sensed that I was struggling with something, but what? I didn't even have the language to describe what was missing from my life, let alone the tools to fix it. So, as a social scientist, I turned to the data for an answer. I devoured every academic paper I could find related to human connection, attended conferences to learn from leading researchers, and sought out opportunities such as working at the University of Pennsylvania's Positive Psychology Center and spending a summer as a visiting scholar with the Mind and Life Institute. I learned that pro-social behaviors, actions that connect us to others, such as gratitude, kindness, and empathy, rewire our brains and change the physiological functioning of our bodies. I learned that people not only are happier, but also live longer when they have good relationships. The stakes were higher than I had originally suspected. To live long and to live well, the data showed, we need love. But I still couldn't put a finger on what all this really meant. It seemed that researchers were getting at a common theme from their different silos, but there was not a satisfying overarching narrative or clear path forward for everyday people like you and me going about our lives. Then, in 2013, I received a grant from Stanford University to develop a campaign and mobile app to help people deepen their relationships. And that's when I found it. While gathering evidence for the project, I discovered the solution to the puzzle, the unifying theme, the language that captured what I was yearning for in life: social health. In the early 1970s, a scholar at Southern Illinois University named Robert D. Russell published a paper titled Social Health, an attempt to clarify this dimension of well-being. He had noticed that the World Health Organization defined health as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, but that no one had really developed the third component. Russell conducted surveys and interviews to arrive at a definition. Social health, he wrote, is the dimension of an individual's well-being that concerns how he gets along with other people, how other people react to him, and how he interacts with social institutions and societal mores. Everything clicked when I read this for the first time. That's it, I thought. Now I just need to learn everything I can about social health and I'll be set. Except there was almost nothing else available. I scoured the library and searched online, in academic journals and popular media. There was no shortage of information on related concepts, like social connectedness, and even social well-being. But social health had a different and crucial connotation. Russell had passed away in 2005, and aside from a few mentions here and there, no one I could find had elaborated on his definition in a robust, meaningful way. Outside of academia, social health was glaringly absent from public discourse. As I write this, 10 years later, there's still not even a Wikipedia page about social health. I was baffled. In the months and years that followed, I couldn't stop thinking about social health. To me, the term perfectly captured what I knew from science and personal experience to be true: that not just happiness, but also health is inextricably linked to connection. I liked that it naturally extended the language that I and most people were already familiar with, building on physical and mental health with social health. Yet it had been buried in academia for decades. I wondered, had the idea of social health not made it into the mainstream because it didn't resonate with anyone other than me? Or because it had simply gone unnoticed, its potential underappreciated and waiting to be realized? It was possible, I hypothesized, that social health just needed a good publicist. Moreover, it needed a framework, a tangible approach for people to strengthen social health as we do physical and mental health. Since I couldn't find one, I was going to have to make one. Over the next decade, I set out to do exactly that. First, I tested my hypothesis by using the term in conversations with friends and colleagues, writing articles about it for publications like Scientific American and Psychology Today, and giving talks about it for organizations across sectors and communities around the world. People's reactions and feedback affirmed that the term social health resonated with more than just me. When I started spreading the message publicly, I felt like a soloist. I was stunned and delighted the first few times I heard or read someone else casually mention social health in conversation or in writing, as part of their normal vocabulary. Today, people in and out of my circles use it all the time, and there is a rapidly growing global choir that gets louder by the day. Emboldened by the spreading of the term, I turned my attention to developing a methodology. I knew the real test of an idea isn't in a laboratory or data set, it's in real life. So I started where I lived at the time, in San Francisco. I organized a public gathering and invited local leaders to speak about what they were hearing and seeing on the ground. Learning that many older adults felt isolated and many teenagers were craving offline connection. At another event, I brought together younger and older community members for an afternoon of conversation across ages, which resulted in intergenerational friendships that continue to this day, showing me how easy it could be to spark connection. I joined the board of a local nonprofit that built community among older adults, seeing firsthand how people who went from isolated to connected experienced better health outcomes as a result. Increasingly, I read news headlines about a rise in loneliness, which added fuel to the fire of my determination. This was a profound need in the world that I believed social health could help. So, in 2019, I took a leap of faith by quitting my job at Verily, the health tech spinoff of Google, to focus on social health full-time. I joined the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health as a graduate student, where I gained perspective on the value of seeing individuals' health, whether physical, mental, or social, as not only influenced by their actions, but also inseparable from the world around them. I learned which tools in the public health tool belt have advanced our collective understanding and improved humanity's health throughout history. And I studied how to use those to prevent loneliness and promote connection.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.